anywhere in America, this would be considered a major college athletic facility. In fact, the NCAA might say that this is a premier college athletic setting. The NCAA also tells us that only one out of every 10 American high school athlete, boy or girl, will ever find their way to a college setting like this. And that is a hard reality. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this is the Inside Corner, a program which attempts to address those realities. Join us, won't you, as we discuss issues and topics both informative and provocative. Good evening, everyone. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this once again tonight is the Inside Corner. The topic this evening is the objective viewpoint of sports writers in our local newspapers. I have asked these gentlemen, now this is our third year I've had them back, and the reason is because I believe that they're impartial, objective observers, and they can educate us about a lot of categories in local high school sports and community sports for that matter. And I wanted you to hear that. I wanted you to hear their impartial opinions about just what is going on as we attempt to educate you and inform you so that you can prioritize sports in your lives and prioritize sports for your youngsters, your sons and daughters. So, the objective opinions of our local sports writers, namely, Alex Janco, of the Suburban Life, what used to be called the Suburban Life, as I understand it
still
now.
Is, yeah.
I bring myself up to date. It is Liberty Suburban Chicago Life Newspapers. Yep. And next to him, one Dave Owens, also of Liberty Suburban Chicago Life Newspapers. And finally, to my right, Mr. George Wilcox of Pioneer Press. His office is in Arlington Heights, a paper that we're not particularly familiar with here, but it has a large coverage area in the northwest suburbs. And so there you have it. Let's get some objective opinions about us, about the kids we watch play, not only at the high school level, but in community athletics as well. Okay.
You put us on the spot already.
Yeah.
I know you all. And all this. I'm well, starting to sweat here under the lights.
I know you all, and I know that you are honest and you are objective. You have no axe to grind. There's no reason why you would favor one school as opposed to another. And so, I mean, you're about as objective a crowd as we're going to get.
You're absolutely right. Yeah. Terry Sullivan is the greatest baseball coach in the history of the state of Illinois.
Well, he's a ghost, that's for sure.
Oh, no, sir.
Okay, my first question. Have you ever witnessed what you would consider to be abusive behavior on the part of a coach, whether it be in community sports or at the high school level? Abusive behavior on the part of the coach, or maybe less drastic, how about unprofessional behavior on the part of a teacher coach or community coach? Have you ever encountered that? One where you'd like to reach out and say, hey, watch what you're doing in front of the kids.
Almost every game I go to, you get that in some facet. I mean, you know, one bad call, they disagree, you know, a parent disagrees, someone disagrees, and you're getting that at every game almost. But I mean, as far as abusive goes, I wouldn't say abusive, but argumentative, you can, any game you go to, you see that.
And how do you measure it? How would you measure that behavior?
Well, I mean, just regular complaining, I have no problem with, but a lot of the times, you know, it gets personal sometimes, but
personal, I mean, between the coach and the official?
Not so much the coach and the official. I mean, the coach, you know, is just out there applauding, doing whatever they do, just riding the official a little bit, trying to get a call. But I've seen it a lot where the parents go over the top, just riding the official, calling them names, the whole game, just going at them.
And the incidences of parents and coaches getting into verbal confrontations?
I've seen. Not any confrontations.
I've never encountered that during game actions or anything. But I don't know if I'm seeing it more and more, but I see a lot of parents getting into coaches' faces after games.
Yeah.
You're doing this to my kid, you're doing that to my kid, the kid's on the bench. We're not in a position to judge why kids get playing time and why kids don't get playing time, but it seems to be something that's creeping up a little more here.
And who's instigating these
ordinary? Well, it's certainly not the coaches. I don't think the coaches are seeking out the parents. Many times after a game, we do the interviews with the coaches, we do the interviews with the kids, and sometimes I'm grabbing my jacket and a parent goes up to the coach, you know, can I talk to you for a while? And then it just gets increasing more and more and more. Where the parents really got something on their mind, and
he's a parent with an axe to grind.
All right, then give me your opinion. Why are there so many parents with axes to grind? Why?
Because their kid should be the star of the team, and they should be getting a scholarship somewhere.
Oh, to the end of the scholarship.
I think so. Yeah, I mean, every parent thinks that their kid is, maybe not every parent, but more so than less, these parents think that their kids are the second coming of, you know, whoever in their sport. And if they're playing, and they should be playing, then they're going to get a scholarship to whichever school they're looking at.
Well, I hope it's not just all for scholarships. I think, a lot of parents are trying to get kids, are trying to make it an important aspect to try to get a scholarship for their kid. But the competition, I think, is more and more prevalent. We have the standings in the newspapers all the time, and the increase of the focus, and we may be part of that, I think the parents get a little nugget of that as well, that, hey, these games are really important to them.
Terry, I was going to spin it back towards the coaching aspect of it, and obviously during games you don't see the Neil Reed type incident where the coach is grabbing the player's throat or allegedly doing so, or regardless, but you see, in a situation where a team is playing poorly, the coach will overreact and scream, and you'll hear him from probably down the hall in the school, much
less across
the gym.
Especially in basketball.
Especially in basketball.
Proximity of the crowd to the bench.
Mm-hmm. But a lot of that, I think, is, you could take that a lot of different ways. A lot of that is a motivational technique to get more out of the player, and I don't know, it's sometimes hard to tell whether it's negative or positive. What I've heard in other situations, especially in practice, is the practices can be kind of crazy and overly aggressive. Where I heard one from one team where a pretty decent player on a team would almost every night, almost every practice would end with her in tears. I mean, one of the players on the team would say, "Oh, it was a pretty good practice today. She only cried once." So it's a case where the teacher or the coach is so demanding upon the players in practice.
In this setting, is it a male coach that you?
It's actually a girls' basketball team.
It's a girls' basketball team with a female coach or a male with a female coach.
But again, I think
all right to bring a kid to tears.
Again, though, it's a fine line between
motivation and berating, motivating
a player to get the most out of themselves and maybe get to that point where they get a college scholarship as opposed to just accepting their
role.
Maybe not aggressiveness.
Yeah. That fine line is where the abuse takes place.
Right, and I think in that case, I heard that story and I just felt terrible for the person who's...
How do we know that the coach who is using moderate or mild beratement of his or her players, how do we know that that really doesn't translate in the coach's mind as you are losing and I am not being fostered? I'm not garnering anything out of being here because you are losing and I'm paying the price. How do we know that it's not all about the coach when the coach is berating the player?
Follow me? Absolutely. Yeah. I tend to, it's a juggling act whether to, is it too harsh on the player and is it destroying the player's confidence? Or is it making the most out of that player? And after she graduates, maybe she'll be playing Division I college basketball, whereas if she hadn't been pushed so hard and even driven to the point of the emotional toll.
This would be an artful thing to do. It would be very artful for a coach to make a player cry every practice or game.
I would never recommend that.
It would be a very artful thing if the coach was making a player cry every day and yet make that a positive thing. Very artful science there.
How many
I made you cry, but
cry.
I made you better. I mean, come on. Usually when people cry, they're not better.
Kevin Garnett story, though, not to defend this coach very much, but like the Kevin Garnett story, he went through a lot of ordeals in South Carolina, which I think made him stronger when he got to Farragut and made him stronger when he got thrust right into the NBA. Mm-hmm. So it's always it's one of those things where you have to wait for the glory of hindsight. You don't know whether you've destroyed this person's love for the game and potential, or whether you've made them into what they could be.
And we don't know if the coach is really saying, the way you play jeopardizes my reputation. We really don't know if the coach is saying that when he does. So.
And this coach is definitely a very high intensity, high strung.
There are a lot of those coaches.
Yeah, a good, very good number.
A lot of those coaches. Okay, let's get back to the parent situations. What's the worst parent behavior episode you've ever seen?
I'd have to say at a basketball game I was at, the school, which will remain nameless, up above the bleachers, there's two sets of bleachers, and in front of the upper deck, I guess you'd call it, there's a little walkway. Girls basketball, and throughout the game, this guy, who is one of the girls' dads, would just walk up and down, follow the play, and just screaming at his daughter what to do. You know, don't listen to the coach. Yeah. Just, you know, he's screaming, shoot the ball, turn around, 360, poster up. Just every game, every single game, even road games. He'd walk the last row of the bleachers just yelling, you know, do this, do that, shoot it here, you know, spin, fade away. I mean, you just want to. I don't want to say what I wanted to do to the guy, but and it just gets old after a while. It really does.
And didn't his daughter wind up playing at three schools in four years?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Shopping she coaches? Played.
Yeah. No. Just shopping schools more
shopping
than anything.
Schools where she
as a freshman she played at one school, sophomore, junior another school, and senior year she transferred to another school. So.
Yeah. Whose dream was it? Huh? Was it the father's dream or the kid's dream?
Yeah, his dream, definitely.
Was his name Pearsall by any chance?
No. No.
No.
No.
Jimmy Pearsall has the best insights. For those of you who are, fortunately, too young to recognize the name Jimmy Pearsall, Jimmy Pearsall was a major league player who admittedly is certified was at one time mentally ill, spent time in institutions. And there was a substantial motion picture about him called Fear Strikes Out. But he has the best explanations for the parents who live vicariously through their kids and push their kids, and the dream really belongs to the parents rather than the kids. So this wasn't Mr. Pearsall pushing the dog.
No,
no,
it was no,
somebody
it
else. Another one just like it.
Yeah.
Fear Strikes Out.
No, I think actually compared to Jimmy Pearsall's
normal,
straight,
compared to
narrow compared to a lot of these.
Really,
I think. In fact, he's probably got the right attitude about a lot of things. But
parent behavior, George, anything unusual?
Well, in addition, just those basketball games are the ones where I'll see the parents get in the face of the coach after the game or anything. But I get to cover up in the northwest suburbs some of the best soccer programs in the Chicago area, and. Soccer parents, maybe it's that genre, maybe it's that group, but soccer parents get out of line quite often. Maybe it's because of the nature of the game and the calls of the referee can go one way or another. But I've seen a few soccer parents get tossed out of games.
Okay, isn't this interesting? Correct me if you think I'm wrong about this, but of all the sports played in America, Americans have had the least experience with soccer,
yeah.
But it's not our sport.
Yeah.
Therefore, how many soccer parents who have played soccer at a sophisticated level, how many parents could there be?
No, and maybe so their ignorance or maybe their lack
how much,
of knowledge.
How many parents do we have who know the game more than the coach? Yeah, right.
But Terry, I think a lot of parents look at it that way, that this is a simple game. It's like kickball at recess. And why isn't my kid playing scoring more goals? And there's no stats it's not like basketball where you can have assists, steals, rebounds. Yeah. It's all about scoring and this. And
goals
a lot of
assists,
players on the field go totally
right.
Unheralded, unless the coach is singing their praises.
Are you agreeing with George that the soccer group
absolutely. I've seen a couple parents kicked out of soccer games just for abusive behavior.
What level?
Yelling. Oh, varsity high school
level.
Just parents. There's one ref out there for, 20 kids on the field?
That's a big thing.
He's not going to see everything. I mean, you have your linesman, but...
You guys got to go over to Europe to see some real fan behavior.
Well, yeah.
I'm standing up for soccer, at least in this country. There's still
some hope.
Yeah, they're not throwing chairs at each other yet. So,
AYSO, is it having any effect? Because AYSO has the most wonderful guidelines for players and parents alike.
They hit varsity high school soccer and something goes wrong then.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Again, it's that possibility of the scholarship or... And how? What is that possibility? I mean, it's minuscule, really, right. When you get this to discuss.
Actually, it's club soccer is where you get your scholarships from anyway. Most of them.
My horror story, as it were, Terry, was involves really two schools. It was the same parent who had a daughter at one school and a son at another. At the daughter, he proceeded to begin to churn out press releases and send them in under the auspices of the school. And they would be completely biased towards his daughter's accomplishments as he attempted to get her a college scholarship.
He would send them into your paper?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And others.
And then the athletic director would follow by saying, this does not represent anything from our school, disregard this information. And it would be full of misstatements, misfacts, but this person was so desperate to get his child a college scholarship. And she was a very talented player, granted.
Holy mackerel.
Well, then his son.
What a whack job. Oh, my God.
Well, his son turned out to be even worse because he was a very good high school player, but a very good high school player in Illinois is not going to get a college scholarship unless you're at one of the biggies, the Mount Carmel Australia Catholics and such. But he turned around and threatened to sue the coach because his son didn't get a college scholarship, mm-hmm. like it was a birthright.
Mm-hmm.
So he had two interesting cases.
I believe it's the Supreme Court that said athletics are a privilege to be earned in schools, not a right.
Mm-hmm.
They're a privilege to be earned. That's why we have separate codes of behavior set for. We're allowed to do that because the court has ruled it's at the privilege level and not at the enfranchisement level. So. Parents suing coaches is a bizarre thought.
Yeah, and I think it's becoming more and more prevalent.
They should just know the statistics Division I scholarships in all categories.
Right. And he was an extreme example, but now you have a lot of, every time there's an athletic code violation, the lawyers will come in, and that becomes a whole other matter, too, where there's always some kind of threat, at least, of litigation against the school if your player is not
bogus,
given enough.
Bogus press releases. Interesting, because we're going to discuss what happened to De La Salle in a defamation case, and that's exactly what the father did there, too, for a different reason. Okay. It's a crazy world, let me tell you. Have you ever had a coach ask you to purposely portray his team or his program in a favorable light?
I currently have a problem with a coach up in the northwest suburbs.
Asking you to do that.
Where he likes to dictate what I write about and what I don't write about in my stories.
Really?
And he's a voracious reader of the paper, but the conflict is what's newsworthy and what's not newsworthy. Mm-hmm. And when one of his players is gone for a couple of weeks because of mononucleosis, one of his starters or main players, I think that's information that should be in the paper, but he has a different opinion that anything about injuries or absences of his players shouldn't be mentioned in the paper. And it's a conflict that we go back and forth on and really haven't been able to find any middle ground on. I'm constantly fighting, I don't know, but because we write for weekly newspapers, a lot of coaches, maybe a lot of readers automatically assume that all of our stories have to be positive upbeat and exciting. And I don't go about a story thinking about that I'm going to write a negative or a positive story. Okay. I'm just trying to report what's happening.
Right. And that's the way
Let me report what's happening right now right here. And that is we have to take a break for a public service announcement. But we will be right back in just about a minute or two. Please join us again. We're at Channel 99. You have found us. That's wonderful. We'll be right here waiting for you.
Sun'll come out tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow there'll be sun. Just thinking about tomorrow. Hear the way the cobwebs and sorrow. Till there's none. When I'm sick in the day. That's gray and lonely. I just stick out my chin and grin. And say,
tomorrow, tomorrow, I love ya. Tomorrow, you're only a day away.
is our hope. Please, give today.
Nobody really likes to vacuum, but it's an everyday chore that I don't really take for granted anymore. I've had a heart transplant. Prior to my transplant, I couldn't even walk to my mailbox without feeling really, really tired. The heart transplant has given me my life back, but it's not just my life anymore. It's allowed me to have a son. And this is Trent. He's a handful, but a good handful. Without this heart transplant, I would actually not be around anymore.
Good job, Lookie Bug.
The transplant has allowed me to be a regular mom. I'm able to take my son to the park. I'm able to push him on his bike. Anything that a young mom loves to do with her kid, I do.
You have the power to donate life. Be an organ and tissue donor. To find out how, go today to donatelife.net.
Thanks for coming back. Again, my name is Terry Sullivan, and this is the Inside Corner. And the topic this evening is the opinions of objective observers, namely our local sports writers from the Life newspaper system and the Pioneer Press out of Arlington Heights. We have Alex Janco and Dave Owen and George Wilcox, sports writers for many years. Alex being the most junior of the set. How many years now, Alex?
About five, 6 years
five
now.
Five or six. Yeah. How many years for you, Terry?
I've been doing this 12 years.
12. David?
I'm up over 12 now.
Over 12. Okay, good. So you see, we have experience. Experience watching us, the behavior of parents and players and teachers and coaches, and that's what we're looking for, their observations, their impartial observations. We were discussing, have you ever had a coach come to you and ask for favorable treatment of his players or team or program in your newspaper? And George, you were telling the story of a guy who's on your case right now.
Yeah, I was reliving the story of conflicts I've been having with a boys basketball coach over, I guess, the tone of my stories. I go about games, I go about my stories, I try to be objective. I'm not a fan of his team, I'm not from the area. And I try to report what's happening. And when sometimes teams are having lousy games or playing poorly, I'll write about that. And when they're playing well, I'll write about that as well. Mm-hmm. But it's sometimes when the team is playing poorly, the coaches can't read about that. I'd like to find more positive angles from a team that's 6-15 on the season. Sometimes that's a little difficult.
Difficult to do. What do we have, any of these encounters? Pressure from coaches?
No.
Or other officials at schools to write more positive things about their teams?
Well, recently a coach said, was talking about how little talent his team has and told me, you know, don't write that. These kids are already, they're like 1-15 or worse. Yeah. And so it would be like announcing that the sun's going to rise tomorrow. So it wouldn't be any news to him anyway. But that would be the only example that I can think of. And you know, Georgia's situation, you try to put a positive spin as much as possible on things to a degree, but there is a point where you become, you don't want to be a Pollyanna or somebody and make yourself look totally ridiculous singing the praises of a team.
It makes for boring writing, too.
Exactly.
And readers detect.
And exactly.
They know whitewash when they see
it. Yeah, they'll think you're a fool, basically.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, back to the coaches. Do you think there's any real incompetence right now? I mean, you got somebody in mind that you really think should not be associated with kids? These are objective opinions now, and strictly opinions. We won't mention any names, but who else could we ask this question? Who would we ask this question? Of whom could we ask this? Are there any coaches you see coaching kids right now in our area, community-wise or high school-wise, that you feel are incompetent and shouldn't be associating with kids?
I wouldn't say incompetent. I mean, there's always a coach or two that might be a bit in over their head, but I would never call
in terms of athletic knowledge.
Yeah, I mean, they're good with kids. That might be the reason they got the job, just because they know how to deal with kids. Mm-hmm. But their knowledge of the sport might not be, you know, expert. But I mean, I wouldn't call that incompetent. I would just, you know, it's just a coach that's in over his or her head.
Okay, in terms of athletic knowledge.
Right.
But like you say, they may not have the athletic acumen, but they may really know about kids, and
exactly.
That's even more important.
Exactly.
What about you, David? Anxious.
I think there's several.
Several. I knew it.
And if you rewind the tape about 15 minutes, you might find one who might just border on it. You know, sending
Dave,
the kid
Dave
home
will
crying
always stir the pot for you. Yeah.
You could argue certainly that that may be crossing the line.
I worry about him. Yeah.
It's it's a very a coach who's had success, and that is probably the savior of some of these situations. What is bothering me, and more and more, I'm not familiar with all the details of the situation, but when a coach like a John Yane at Nazareth, who is nothing but positive and a fantastic person, a very knowledgeable coach, successful every year, and he left very early under circumstances. Mm-hmm.
Controversial circumstances, definitely.
And I think a situation like that is the opposite. I think there's a lot of, he's someone who should be coveted by schools and hopefully will be immediately scooped up somewhere else. Yeah. And yet there's a lot of people out there who either are too hard on kids or do not have knowledge of the game. And to invoke John's name, he's certainly one that is very good.
Wherever there are humans, there are stupid human games. Mm-hmm. There are stupid human politics. Wherever there are humans.
Yeah. But I would put him in the list. There's it's a pretty long list of
really
good ones.
I really don't know the whole story, but I do know John.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He was a student of mine in my English classroom in the last century. I know he's a very conforming personality, amiable one, likes kids, and is a good values teacher.
I think rather than sound negative though about things, I'd like to, you know, commend the John Yanas, the Jack Durnings here at Lyons Township, the Don Schabachers, the John Belskis at Downers Grove South. And I'm going to miss about 10 or 20.
Those are all proven coaches.
Who are not only win, but are outstanding people. And
they care about the kids.
They care about the kids, and win or lose.
Wins and losses are okay, but it's how you conduct yourself on the field or on the court that's important.
And they have rules that are important that these kids will take with them for life, which go far beyond wins and losses, and that's what's more important.
There are many in education, including good superintendents of good school districts, who will tell you that they think, as I always did, that the grander opportunity in education is in coaching rather than the classroom. Mm-hmm. Classroom is great and very fulfilling, but the emotional sharing in the athletic field gives a teacher coach even more leverage to change kids' lives. The grander opportunity is in coaching. And when you see a bad coach, an incompetent coach in a situation, the damage is quadrupled against the weak teacher in the classroom.
You can shatter a kid. A bad coach can
there's
just
so
shatter
much emotion
a kid.
Involved.
And a lot of times you find a coach who incompetent becomes kind of iffy because they do things that are somewhat unethical or just downright strange, and they're very successful. Again, not naming names, but I heard a story earlier this year, which I hope isn't true, but a player in the postseason had received a DUI from high school, and the coach's first reaction was, well, why did he blow into the breathalyzer?
Oh, man.
I mean, if that's the attitude that is prevalent
at
some schools.
And this coach is a full-time teacher at this school also?
Yes.
And he immediately goes for the circumvention of the principle. He doesn't see the principle of the thing. He goes for the circumvention of the law. Why did he blow in? Why did he blow into the breathalyzer?
Yeah, and on the other hand, you have the Belskises, the Durnings, and many of the others I mentioned, and many, many more that I'm not mentioning, who.
No, that's a real indictable remark. That guy should be fired.
Yeah, but these guys are strict. They have rules, and if you break them, you will be.
Okay, the problem is they're it's a weak athletic director and a weaker principal.
Yeah. And again, you're worried that the parents will come in with a high-priced lawyer or any lawyer and threaten to sue. And what school district wants to go through that and the expense?
Well, they don't.
Yeah.
Schools quake when they think about what it's going to cost to defend themselves against frivolous lawsuits.
And that's what I think is one of the scarier trends, I think, right now in high school sports.
You know, but someone's got to stand up for what's correct somewhere. Schools do. Mm-hmm. Homewood Fosmer has a drug testing policy. How courageous is that? You know, they took a stance.
More schools should have it, I think. Absolutely.
All right, talking about what's ethical and what isn't ethical behavior. There is recently in the newspaper, there was the story of the baseball coach at De La Salle High School and his confrontation, legal confrontation with a parent. The story goes that the son of the parent is cut from the baseball team, the varsity baseball team. The father writes a letter of complaint to the principal of the school. He gets nowhere after sending his letter to the principal. It remains so. His son is cut from the baseball team. He then draws up bogus press releases giving the impression, stating that they are from the Illinois High School Athletic Association, the IHSA. And he distributes these bogus press releases to all the newspapers that make any difference in the Chicago area. The coach sues the parent for defamation of professional character. He wins and is awarded $800,000. The question in my mind when I read that is, where is the world going? How can anyone be so Machiavellian as to write false press releases, knowing full well that his kid is cut, is never going to be placed back on the team? To what end would you want to injure the teacher, coach, right or wrong? Why would you want to go to that extent? What kind of a mentality would do that? Do you think that this story, and it's a real story, a true story, is indicative of a trend, a growing mentality amongst parents? Has that been your observation? I mean, are we going to see more of this drastic reaction on the part of parents toward the placement of their kids on prime athletic teams? What's wrong with America?
Not if you're going to have to fork over $800,000.
Yeah, right. It's inhibiting.
Unless it's Randy Moss's child. He apparently doesn't care how much money he has to give.
I guess there are a lot of coaches and teachers cheering that verdict, because I'm sure it's been. Yeah. But it was really extreme to write up false reports.
Yeah,
false releases.
But I don't think it's that really extreme.
I love the story, by the way, or whatever. The only thing that surprised me about it, that it was a baseball coach and not a hockey coach or something. Mm-hmm. That's what I was expecting from hockey parents of all kinds.
Yeah, you don't get that in baseball too.
But no, the story like that might be another step in the direction of how nutty and crazy everything is getting. And it was a few years ago that Tom Myers, the former football coach up
Lake
in Lake
Forest,
was fired, and he's filed a suit for
wrongful firing,
rightful firing, yeah. And all kinds of things. And then the Lake Forest athletic department's all gone through all kinds of other problems with their other coaches. But that's what I got out of the story most of all, just another step of how crazy and loony maybe parents seem to be going.
The entire idea of this, my kid needs a scholarship thing, is out of control to start with.
They should read the statistics on that.
They should visit Lyons Township and go in the lobby of your gym and look at Jeff Hornacek's picture and understand his story.
He had no college scholarship.
He had no college scholarship. Right. No one knew who he was. He walked down at Iowa State. He made it. He made something of himself. Yeah. And
that's how tough it is to get a scholarship.
NBA career.
Less than 1%, I can speak to baseball scholarships, less than 1% of all of the high school baseball players in the state of Illinois will receive Division I baseball scholarships. Mm-hmm. Only 10% of all the high school baseball players in Illinois will be playing college baseball, Division I, II, or III, or junior college. So the statistics are the statistics discriminate against your chances.
But the problem is all these parents think that their kid is that 1 in the 10%. Yeah. That's what the problem is. And they think that by these coaches not playing their kid, is not getting the chance to show his skills, his or her
De La
Salle,
that coach got in the way of my kid's career, I'll fix that coach.
Yeah. And if the kid got cut, he couldn't have been that good to begin with. How
he appeals to the president of the high school, as they're called in the Catholic school system, the president of the high school, the principal.
And you would think
the principal says what is
with the coach. Yeah.
He wasn't good enough, according to the expert that we hired to run the situation. Your son is cut. There's lots else to do at De La Salle. Why doesn't he try that? That's not good enough. He writes up press releases maligning the coach, forges them as from the IHSA.
Unbelievable.
$800,000 later, we have a resolution to the problem.
Well, I applaud the courts for rewarding the guy $800,000, make an example of the parent.
I want to see how much he sees. He'll probably see about $80 if he's lucky.
Make an example of the parent. That's how you stop it.
I mentioned Jeff Hornacek. What would happen today if there were statute of limitations if Michael Jordan's family decided to, or Scottie Pippen's, they were cut in high school or junior high.
Cut. That's right, yeah.
Dennis Rodman didn't play until like junior or senior year of high school. And what would be the implications there with when you look back in hindsight? But it's just high school sports is not the end all. Some players develop later than others, and if a coach decides you're not good enough to play on the team, you've got to live with it and work harder, and there's still a way to make something of yourself, and there's many examples.
It's all in this misperception that sports are so important. We have placed so much importance upon athletic achievement.
There are so many great stories.
And so much important on celebrity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the two of them are combined in athletics. I mean, if you're you're going to be a celebrity if you're an athletic star.
Too much
on the superficial.
I can name so many athletes who barely got college attention. Ben Roethlisberger had two scholarship offers, Ohio State to sit on the bench. He went to Miami of Ohio, and look at him now, 4 years later, in the AFC championship game. And they're just prevalent everywhere. There are opportunities out there. And
how about the kid plays the violin?
Late
That's
bloomers.
An opportunity, too.
Exactly.
It? He plays the violin now that you didn't make the baseball team.
And
he's now you go out for the math club.
Right. And they put in just as much time as your athletes do.
I'm sorry, Alex. What about the situation like at Glenbardise where they're dropping gymnastics, wrestling? They're dropping a number of sports. What if you're a wrestler or a gymnast with Olympic potential Division I potential at a school that has wrestling or gymnastics, and now you've had your opportunity totally taken away because the program's been cut? Mm-hmm. What's the repercussions or reparations for that?
Yeah. When I think back to all the kids that I was fortunate enough to coach over the years, and how many of them I see now, and I think about what they're doing, it trivializes baseball. It trivializes baseball. I mean, there are Secret Service agents, doctors, and lawyers, ministers, performers, firefighters, police. It trivializes baseball. And so the dad goes out and writes a phony press release. Phony press releases to get back at that guy who took the career away from his kid.
Yeah. Sports is supposed
job.
Sports is supposed to teach how to work as a team and work together, and now you've got a couple of crazy parents who come in and ruin the whole idea of it.
Every setting has a couple of parents. It's Noah's Ark when it comes to that situation. So, again, we are going to take just a couple of minutes to do public service announcements. They're a federal requirement, by the way. I congratulate you one more time for finding us on Channel 99. Please program your remote control to automatically scan stations, and you'll find us at 99 all the time. You won't have to just fall upon us. We'll be back briefly, and we're waiting for you right here.
I'm John. I was blinded in a chemical explosion that left me blind for 30 years. I was given my sight back through a cornea transplant. All I had wanted was to see my children for the very first time. When they removed the bandages, I looked across the room, and sitting there was my family. I could see them.
You have the power to donate life. Be an organ and tissue donor. To find out how, go today to donatelife.net.
Once it was silent, but the spirit of America made liberty ring. And once it was weak, but the spirit of America made hope stand tall. And if our spirit can do all this, imagine what we can do for all Americans in poverty. We can let liberty ring for millions of kids in need. We can let freedom stand for every family working for independence. Poverty in America, we can end it, and everyone can help. Learn how at povertyusa.org.
Thanks for coming back. My name is Terry Sullivan. This is the Inside Corner. And tonight we have the opinions of objective and impartial sports writers from local newspapers. And we just finished discussing the De La Salle defamation case, if you happen to have read that in the newspaper, wherein the coach sues the parent who has been maligning him, some with really what turns out to be illegal documents, and receives an $800,000 judgment. Amazing. This is all about whether or not his kid was good enough to play on the varsity baseball team. Go figure. Okay. How do you envision the ideal prep sports section for a community newspaper, much like your newspapers? What's the ideal sports section?
Dave, you've been pretty opinionated tonight. I have
a two-word answer, balanced coverage. Try to give as equal coverage as you can to all sports. And if
would you include
if a team is more successful,
community sports in that coverage?
To a degree, I mean, reluctantly to a degree.
Grade school basketball?
Reluctantly.
We fight with that quite often, trying to incorporate youth soccer and Little League, but our space for newspapers are dictated by advertising and other factors. Mm-hmm. We just don't have as much space as we'd
love
to
have. How many pages do you get at the Pioneer Press, for instance, in sports?
It's the same. You guys are a broadsheet, but we're more of a tabloid. But it's five or six pages.
Five or six pages.
A week, yeah.
And you guys get
it like five to eight, maybe ten if we get lucky. But I mean, a lot of it, like he said, is advertising. So half of our pages are filled with ads. Anyway,
I like to see what I look for in good prep sections for weekly papers is papers that do cover a balanced amount of sports. Mm-hmm. We try to cover bowling, we try to cover girls gymnastics, we try to cover the whole spectrum, and a paper that tries to get a lot of names in the paper as much as possible because the readers and the fans and parents would like to see names in the paper. And
you can't always glorify one person on that team. You have to try to, even if it's the third or fourth girl or boy in the results, you have to try to work them in somehow. It's not just your top finisher all the time.
And the fear with, as you mentioned about community sports, is a lot of times some coaches will be more cooperative than others, and then you wind up being totally biased against certain teams that don't have the publicity machine that others do. Mm-hmm. So as much as we'd love to give a lot of coverage to even the younger kids, a lot of times we don't get the same cooperation.
Right. You don't get the...
It ends up very unbalanced.
Nothing coming in, nothing goes
and we'd
going out.
We'd be working 90, 100-hour weeks
trying to find it all.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard the complaint that... First of all, you have a private school in your coverage area. Mm-hmm. It happens to be a Catholic school. And you have more than one.
Three. I do three.
Nazareth, Fenwick, St. Joe's. No.
Well, I do Naz, Joe's, and IHM. But we also do Fenwick too. Yeah.
And then Dave, you have the same mix to contend with, don't you?
I have a little bit of Montini.
A little bit of Bennett too.
We only have one Catholic high school in the northwest suburb, that's St. Viator, that I cover regularly. We have Mundelein Carmel up north. But the amount of Catholic schools are not as prevalent as in the west suburbs.
Okay, I asked that because here's a question. This is a criticism that I've heard. I think it's personally a prejudice. Your response by saying I think it's a illogical criticism. But here's the criticism. The criticism is the kids who are at the private school, most of them do not live in the distribution area of the newspaper.
Correct. Yep. Absolutely.
They live outside the distribution area. So why do they get an equal part of the balance that you're trying to create? How do you answer that question?
I mean, if the school's in the coverage area, you have to give them the same amount of coverage. I mean, if I know a lot of kids, I mean, I cover Nazareth football. I get a roster with hometowns on it. There's a lot of Nazareth football players that are from Chicago, which we don't cover. We stop at Berwyn and Cicero. But you have kids on the team. It's LaGrange Park. We have a LaGrange Park paper. If the kid scores the game-winning touchdown, he gets the press. It doesn't matter where he's from. You have to report what happens. I guess you try to mold it towards a particular angle, but I mean, you can't sidestep.
Have you ever fielded that complaint? Why are you writing about that school when that school has more? Their kids don't live in our area.
Not really. I mean,
Well, you guys,
not so much.
I don't. We try not to write. At least maybe from my experience, I try not to write my stories geared toward the students, toward the athletes, or the coaches. I try to write my stories for the fans, the ones that are going to go to the games, or the ones that even more so can't get to the games, right. And I'm there for them. That's what I gear it for. So sometimes, yeah, I don't worry about where the athletes are from. Even up north, even anywhere, whatever private schools. Yeah, the kids are coming from a large area, but the fans who are reading the paper. With a circulation of about 40,000, 50,000, I don't know what you guys have. Very few of that circulation are just the players themselves or the coaches.
What were you going to say? Dan?
We had one case this year with a Montini parent after they won the state title, who was kind of upset that their child didn't get mentioned as much, and they actually lived in the area. So it really is a juggling act. Mm-hmm. You almost have to play a census taker almost and figure out which player lives where. And
you couldn't do that.
It was an unfortunate oversight. And
some of the criticism would like to exclude the private schools from coverage.
Yeah. Well,
and of course, what's illogical about that is some of the private schools have been there as long, if not longer, than the public school.
Right. I think they totally deserve coverage, yeah. and
therefore they're
totally
part of the fabric of the community.
But to change the subject, and this will open a whole new can of worms. But I think they should be playing in their own separate tournaments.
State tournaments. You're right. It's opening up a can of worms.
Absolutely. And it is
opening up a can of worms.
In all sports?
I think I popped. Oh yes, in all sports. I don't think, I think public and private schools should be
separate. Well, it used to be that way.
And I think it should be again. It is in a lot of states still.
It used to be that way, and then there was a clamor that they had been segregated, that they had been discriminated against and could not reap the benefits of IHSA membership. And they let them back in. Now they're wanting to kick them out.
The IHSA is gradually dividing the pie into now you have 8 football classes. Soon we're going to have 16, and then and 32.
It was four basketball classes they're talking about,
and,
right?
So we're going to have four basketball classes.
I'm pretty sure.
And when you're recruiting from an 120 mile area, 30 miles in any direction, and you're competing against schools, and again, I'm going to use an example of someone not far from right here in beautiful LaGrange, Otto Zeman at Riverside Brookfield. This poor guy every year. He has to play a powerhouse from down south. Yeah. One year he almost beat him, and the next 3 years, year it's
I mean, Otto gets kids from Riverside, Brookfield, and North Riverside. You go to Joliet Catholic.
Yeah.
Jeske is from Yorkville. I mean, Yorkville and Joliet aren't that close on the map, and you know, I mean, when you have that radius, like you said,
they
have
a
30-mile
radius.
Yeah,
and one of the girls' Catholic basketball, one of the girls' basketball powers. Has a girl in Beverly, which is the edge of the south side of Chicago, and she's going to Fenwick. Yeah. So it's.
Wonder why.
Yeah.
That's another story.
It is. It's a totally
bring
another story.
Bring us back next week. We'll discuss that topic. Yeah.
Another story. Okay, paper heroes. Do you think you're creating paper heroes when you emphasize the accomplishments of one high school athlete? When you make, I know the Life papers do this, I imagine George's paper does it too. When you have the athlete of the year, and that athlete doesn't make his college team, have you made a paper hero? And is that good or bad? Huh? Have you created false hopes and ambitions in a kid by singling him out? And then maybe we inflate his abilities, and maybe he inflates his own abilities, and have we set him up for a horrible regret later on? Is he?
If I could tell the future like that, boy, I would have bought Yahoo at 25 cents.
I do worry about that from time to time. Seriously, whether so much coverage that we leap upon a certain individual is too much. I covered the end of the Tom Zbikowski's career at Buffalo Grove, and this was a guy that was doing weekly appearances with Bob Sakamoto on CLTV, was writing a diary for ESPN.com, and is now a sophomore at Notre Dame, and we did leap a lot of things on his shoulders. And at Notre Dame, at the beginning of this year, he took a 1 week just left the team for 1 week to try to regain his senses because he was fighting over a position job. But I do worry about often if we put too much pressure on some of these guys. And frankly, the daily newspapers are involved a lot of that. Yeah. The Tribune and the Sun-Times is currently building up this Derek Rose of Simeon, the sophomore guard, as the next big high school basketball player out of Chicago.
Well, a couple years ago, we had Jim Maley at LT. He was our player of the year. I remember doing a big story on him when he agreed to go to Northwestern. He was there for probably, I don't know, 3-4 months, and he just lost his desire to play basketball and quit the team. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know if that was us. If he just got tired of playing.
Yeah,
if it was the
college. You wonder if you were part of some.
Yeah, I mean, it might have been adjusting to the college life. I don't know what it was, but you know, you sit and wonder.
It's pretty hard to ignore a player like that.
He was a great high school player,
right?
And a great kid.
I mean, he led them downstate. Yeah.
If a Maley or a Grant Johnson, what they do in high school, you have to. Unless you're being completely biased,
your paper is always in the present tense.
Right. Exactly.
That's your chore, right?
And you can't ignore the present tense, great accomplishments.
So if they're great.
Right.
Now.
In March of 2002, Jim Maley was the best player in our area, so therefore he was our player of the year.
There's no way to look into the crystal ball and think, boy,
and if he winds up a doctor, it's a big disappointment.
Yeah, he's doing fine either way.
Who's to say he couldn't be their starting guard right now if he would have stayed there? I mean, you don't know.
If that's important. It reminds me of a John Updike poem called Flick Webb. I don't know if you're familiar with this poem. I'll tell you the story of the poem. It's a narrative poem. It's the great player at the local high school, 40 points a game, and his Flick could really shoot the ball. Well, he didn't make his college team because he just wasn't good enough. That happens. Mm-hmm. The local hero in the little pond goes off to the big ocean, and he's just ordinary. Well, you can find Flick now down at the local gas station pumping gas. And when he doesn't have anything better to do, he flicks rolled up paper into the waste can and turns to the layers of candy on the display case, waits for applause from the Necco wafers. It's a great poem. It says a lot.
Yeah,
I almost have that right now. I mean, I cover St. Joseph's, so with a basketball team, we have Tony Freeman.
Yeah.
I'd put him in the top five players in the state of Illinois, probably. He's going to Iowa. You know, have us back in 2 years. You know, he might be NBA bound. He might not even be in school. You can't tell. I mean, it's really hard to say. Yeah. But as of right now, Tony Freeman is the man.
Well, you write in the present tense.
Yeah,
that's your answer. That's,
I don't sit and say, well, what's he going to
be
doing?
You write in the present tense.
Right.
Who's good now gets the attention. I mean, if he's the great high school player, he is.
Yeah.
If he doesn't turn out to be the greatest player at Stanford, that's because it's a big country. Now, why isn't there more investigative or editorial sports writing in your papers? I mean, when we have a controversy at a high school, why aren't you guys involved in it? Why is
It's not that we stay away from anything like that. I think we'd all love to do those stories, but stories like that often take a lot more time, a lot more research, a lot more background to work on.
Has it ever been proposed to allow you to do that?
Oh, no.
Are you encouraged to do that?
Yeah, we've tackled, I mean, at our paper at Pioneer Press, we've tackled the whole public versus private debate recently. When the year began, we did a whole section focusing on different issues from the players to the coaches to the referees about the issue, but it's time consuming, and it's something that of course eats up a lot of space and other things.
Yeah. Takes up a lot of time more than anything. I mean,
are you guys encouraged to write editorial opinion or?
Well, you know whether I'm encouraged or not. Yeah. Listening to my big mouth tonight, you know I do it.
No, would you like to? Would you like to write?
Yeah.
For instance, in the Yana story.
Right. I was going to allude to that.
Would you like to have been given the rein, the free rein, to explain
the only problem
to your
is
readers?
Depending if I do uncover something, if I portray the school in a bad light, what am I going to do to my connections at the school? They're not going to want to talk to me. I might lose readers, depending. You know, what I uncover, it gets to the point where you ask yourself, is it worth it? Is uncovering this story worth cutting off all these contacts, having everybody at the school, you know, cancel their subscriptions, not want to talk to me? You know, I mean, it's very, you know.
Artful.
Yeah, it is. You have to really think about it.
I did that once, breaking a story, and the coach wouldn't talk to me for 2 years. Yeah. So it can be very touchy. And on another level, it can be touchy. Just if it's really, really controversial, you worry again about whether you're crossing that line of libel or even a threat of a lawsuit. Mm-hmm. And in our positions, that's the last thing we want to, top of all the other responsibilities we have.
Right.
Even as high school reporters, don't we face the same problems as a beat reporter for the Cubs or Sox?
In a sense, definitely.
Yeah, absolutely.
Different scale.
But it is.
Same.
Well, George, you worked at the Sun-Times.
I worked at the Sun-Times for 4 years. Yeah. And,
what was your role there?
High school reporter, and it was mainly as a stringer, a part-time basis, and it meets with some different situations, different problems. Is that the coaches, the kids, the coverage probably asks less of you in a way, they don't count on you to be the hometown newspaper or your rah-rah rooter so much, which is what I think we in the weekly newspaper business are always trying to fight against. Is the idea that we always have to be rooting for the local team.
Yeah.
The Sun-Times presents more difficult challenges, as though just in terms of deadlines that we don't always face. Being in the weekly, we have a little more time to nurture and work on the story and work on more feature stories all the time. Mm-hmm. That's not always the case over at the Sun-Times.
Who's the best football player you saw this year in high school football?
This year, the couple of them was the Doug Pilcher over at Hinsdale Central,
and then
in a different way, the Garrett Edwards at Downers North, your state champion.
Best football player you saw this year in high school football?
PJ Boyke, Hinsdale Central, running back, cornerback, kick returner. He did everything.
Dave.
Cody Solinsky from Downers North, defensive dominator, one of the best, one of the all-time leaders in quarterback sacks in the state, and the offense. He played at offensive line, and most of Garrett Edwards' big gains were behind him. Yeah. He was just dominant both sides of the ball.
We're watching basketball right now. We're in season. Who's our best girls basketball player in the Life newspapers area?
Probably, I would think Brittany Johnson at Fenwick.
At Fenwick?
Yeah.
That's a good
Dave.
Call. Yeah. I was going to move a little closer and upset all your Lions viewers, but Kelly Dianis at Hinsdale Central is having a fantastic year.
Volleyball. Season's gone by. Who was the best?
Jeanette Abbott from Downers South was quite exceptional. She's going outside hitter, going to Clemson.
Right here at LT, Beth Karpiak was absolutely dominant for them.
And just to say, Jeanette Abbott would be near the top of my list. I was going to take another approach with Jill Mitchell, who barely played at setter a year ago and immediately stepped in this year and played like a veteran and almost an all-state.
And they all have scholarships.
Yep, they do.
Yeah.
They do.
Oh, club volleyball is miraculous.
Well, Alex, thanks for coming by again. Our yearly impartial objective viewpoint.
Thanks for having me.
David, George, my pleasure. Thank you so much.
Can I unveil my Red Sox?
You certainly can. Go ahead. As I'm giving credits, go right ahead. Go right ahead.
And a toast to John Yana and Ron Novelka and the many great coaches in our area.
My thanks to Tom Sklarsky, who is my director, and my producer, Mike May, my main man, and our cable studio manager, Mr. Bob Foskett. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this has been the Inside Corner. Join us again, won't you, on Channel 99. We have an unveiling. We have an unveiling
Wait, first I have a...
World Series champions.
Yeah, there's the logo. All right.
Yep. The man that built the dynasty right here.
May there be many more. But
I have little or nothing to do with it.
Patriots.
Thank you, everyone.
Please.
We'll see you again. Thanks so much.